The kids are expecting a show. Hi, Evan. The kids are expecting a show. Came popping up there on your YouTube that you're supposed to get a show. So while I check and make sure the streams are there, you enjoy the music. It would appear that YouTube is working. There's where Evan is. There's Pedignon 4852. He's there. We're gathering an audience. Go over and check Facebook. And it looks like we're live there. Yay. Gonna pin that up to the featured spot. And take the S install off the featured spot. I'll move it to the front. The music's gone. Ta-da! And we're on the air. So, it is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet, and it is the promo. Okay, I'm going to raise my hand with my thumb pointed at the title over my right shoulder. Ha! Had to think about it for a while. Okay, the promo. It's Sunday. Today is Sunday. So the show is going to be today. 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern. Keeping an eye over on the Zoom just in case I'm joined by anybody. But I gave them short notice that the Zoom is coming up. And I think David's doing his wire talkers thing. 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern, 0200 Zulu, Monday morning Zulu. So that's going to be the show. What is the show going to be? My genius plan for 60 meters. If I got the date right, today, June 11th, yeah, 2023. And this show title is a callback to a show I did 9 years ago. 9 years ago, called My Stupid Plan for 60 meters. Have I got that any place I can show it easily? Wrong. Whoa, wrong. Really wrong button. Well, this is we've actually got a playlist on our YouTube channel for all the 60 meter shows that we've done. So there's the. Come on, show me the channel. How am I going to get to that? My channel. There we go. And if you look at the playlists, among the many playlists, and there's a lot of them, there's a 60 meters playlist. So let's view the whole playlist. And in that playlist is episode 132, parts one and part two, both talking about my stupid plan for 60 meters. And so I'm giving you homework for this afternoon. Now, I don't know about where you are, but where I am, it's a rainy, muggy, kind of dull, blah day. Good day for plugging YouTube into the big screen TV, sitting back and watching a bunch of ham radio now. The part one is particularly a lot of fun.
It encompasses all of the five channels that we've got. I'm going to ask him if I can take the full review, everything that I wrote, and put it on my website. I could rewrite it a little bit. And it's
Jeff and me.
I could sell it to CQ if I wanted.
Jeff AC4ZO and me really bantering about. We banter a little bit about 60 meters. And we banter a lot about other stuff.
Digital QST,
I put the bugs in a different parts of the screen at that time.
Lots longer. The main reason for not making things lots longer is because it takes time to edit and put things together.
Yeah. So, build them all. So,
this whole article.
It was fun to listen to. It takes a long time to get to what the stupid plan is. And then Jeff had to go. So if you go all the way down to, 40 minutes or so into the show, let's see, we're at 43 here.
Meter band. They've been operating HF that way for 100 years with no problem.
My stupid plan back then, they were proposing a much larger band than what they're proposing now. They're proposing a 15 kilohertz wideband now. At the time, the thought was something around 175 kilohertz, but I wanted to see that whole band to be channelized. We've been doing 60 meters on five channels at that point. In 2013, when we did this show, we've been doing 60 meter channels on the five channels for about 10 years, 11 years. 60 meters came about as a ham band in 2002. So I liked the idea of doing all channelized every place. That's not my genius plan today. So what they're proposing for 60 meters now is maybe 15 kilohertz wide band, 9 watts of power, and get rid of the maybe get rid of the other four channels, or maybe not. And so I'm thinking I'm not going to tell you what I'm thinking because I'm going to wait for the show to tell you what I'm thinking. But it's a genius. If I mentioned it's a genius plan, yeah. So it's going to be a genius plan for 60 meters. Also, best I can tell, they still haven't put this thing up in the Federal Register. Or if they have, nobody's making comments on it because it's not, comments are not pouring in. Cindy has come in. She's downstairs. She's talking on the phone. Can you hear? I've got my gate set, so you probably can't hear that low-level noise. Anyway, once again, I still need the revolving red light down there that says, on the air, on the air. All right, so once again, my homework for you guys is to go look at the original show, my stupid plan for 60 meters, and it's only part one and part two. Part one is 49 minutes long. Part two is a little over an hour, so you got plenty of time between now and 10 p.m. to do that, just to fill in the background and look at Jeff one more time because Jeff passed away last year. It was very sad, brain cancer. So, do I have anything else? Oh yeah, yesterday I did another one of those public service events. This was back closer to my old hometown over in Raleigh, but it was down the road from Raleigh a little bit, about not quite a 3-hour drive from here to get started. So it was a bike tour event, preparing, warming up for the big bike MS in September. And they had, I think, about 300 bikes. They had a 65-mile course, a 35-mile course, and a 22-mile course. The 22-mile, I could almost have done that. I can ride my bike. Well, I was riding my bike 20 miles at the peak a few years ago, and then the cancer and other stuff, and I'm working my way back to good health. And I've been riding it around this year 10 miles, 11 miles. I could probably go a little farther. My lungs and my legs are fine. It's my butt won't let me. And I bought a little bit gentler seat, softer seat. I went over to REI and was looking at all the seats they had. And of course, the real hardcore guys, they have these narrow seats that, don't support much. They get the two sit bones and that's about it. And not much padding in them. You're supposed to generate your own ability to tolerate a seat like that. I'm not sure what the point is. And they have a little bit wider, and a little bit plusher. And then they've got what I describe as the tractor seat, big wide thing, very plush. I'm thinking, I am not a hardcore bicyclist. I'm going to go for the tractor seat. But even with that, at this point, I start to feel it at 6-7 miles, and then by 10-11 miles, I'm kind of done. And I've been out on 4 or 5 rides so far this year. And it's going to start getting too hot to ride. So I've ridden almost all the nice days this year. Where was I going? Oh, yeah. So I was going to this bike event where they had 65-mile, 35-mile, and 22-mile. And one repeater, the repeater that they were going to use, is just off the edge of the course, and it's at like 1,400 feet. So it's going to cover the course just fine, except it's got some receive problems. Some noise hits it, always has. And the net control station in the little town where this got started, Sanford, North Carolina, the starting point was on the side of a hill, and they located the trailer for the net. And by the way, I forgot to take pictures. I didn't take any pictures. I don't know why. The net control, they set up the trailer for the net control station at the bottom of the hill. And his signal into the repeater was marginal. It was not quite full quieting best of times. And then when the noise hit the repeater, it didn't take him out, but it made it a little bit harder for him to copy. And meanwhile, everybody else on the repeater, he's saying, "How's my signal? How's my signal?" Everybody else is saying, "Your signal's fine," because they could understand him. They could hear his voice. And I'm going, "You're pretty noisy and you don't have much fade margin." He never totally disappeared. Well, there were some weird parts where he kind of disappeared. We didn't know. I was listening on the input. I could hear him fine. He wasn't keying the repeater at all, but I couldn't figure out why. Without going back and analyzing the equipment, and I was a couple miles away, so I didn't. So it was a little bit weird, but he did a great job. It's just the hams don't give accurate signal reports. They hate it. Hams hate giving bad signal reports. Everything is fine. Your signal is fine. There might be a little bacon fry, a little bit of noise. Oh, you're 5'8". You're pretty good. A little bit of noise in the background. Come on, hams. We can do better. And the new hams out there are learning from the old hams. Don't give a bad signal report. Everyone's going to hate you. So this repeater, when I programmed it in the radio, it's been a while since I've used it. It's out of town from Raleigh by about 25 miles. It's out in the middle of no place, and the towns around it are small. So it doesn't get a ton of use. It does cover up into the Raleigh-Durham area, but there's 1,000 other repeaters up there, so it's not the primary repeater for that. And the small towns around, well, Fayetteville's not too small town, but Fayetteville's got its own repeaters. But this is much wider coverage than the ones in Fayetteville. So it gets some activity from them. But it's not real busy. And it's been a while since I used it. And when I programmed it into the radios, that in a UHF link system that was going to be the backup and the sag-to-sag channel sort of, programmed those into my radios because having moved down here, they weren't part of my radio programming anymore. I programmed that repeater for a subaudible tone decode. I do that for just about all the radios that I have these days. When a repeater is going to send tone, I take advantage of it. It used to be that I had the ham plan that, hang on, I'm distracted looking at Wirecast a little bit. Wirecast isn't telling me that I'm green or anything else. What am I missing? I hope I remember what I was talking about in 10 seconds. Oh, I'm looking at the wrong place. Everything's fine. Never mind. Everything's fine. So I program subaudible tone into all the radios if I can. It used to be that I had the idea that I'm a ham. I want to hear everything. I want carrier squelch, and I want to know when there's noise, and I want to know when there's stuff, and I want to know if there's distant signals rolling in, and if I'm hearing interference, I want to know why. I'm old and curmudgeon-y, and that's not the case anymore. I don't want to hear any of that crap. I want to hear the signal that I'm intending to be tuned in on, and that's all. That may be why I have that stupid plan for 60 meters channelized everywhere. I'm halfway through doing my own homework and listening to my explanation in part two for why I wanted that 175 kilohertz wide band to be channelized everywhere. I want all of HF to be channelized. And you know, when hams say, channelize, that's CB. I say, no, wait, everything, literally every other radio and television service everywhere is channelized. Everything except ham radio. It's not SCB. It's everything else is channelized. We're the only radio service that isn't. And on VHF and UHF, on repeaters and stuff, we voluntarily channelized, and that's the way we made things work. And my main complaint about not being channelized on HF is that if you're on a frequency and you're talking on it for a while, sooner or later, someone is going to get a kilohertz and a half below you or above you or both and start up their own conversation within your receiver passband, too close, and you'll be hearing it on both sides, and you lose the guy that you're trying to talk to because they can dial up. And maybe they're not hearing you, and maybe they just don't care. And I want it all channelized. I don't want anyone with the ability to come up right next to me a little bit above and a little bit below. It's not a popular, I'm doing the microphone finagle, sorry. It's not a popular plan, but that was my stupid plan for 60 meters back then, 9 years ago. Today, it's going to be a little bit different. I'll tell you about it on the show when we get to the show. If we ever get to the show, I may still be talking and doing the promo, and it's not, you know, when it's time to start the show. So, now what was I talking about? Oh, I don't want to hear all of that noise on 2 meters and 70 centimeters. When I pull up to a red light and the computer that's controlling the light cycles is putting out some spurs on typically 2 meters or 220, I hear one. There's an intersection nearby. As soon as I pull up next to it, my 220 squelch opens. And unfortunately, the local 220 repeater doesn't send tone, so I can't go subaudible tone decode on that, at least not yet. I talked to the guy that programs it, and he says, maybe we can. But he's got to go up a tower 1,500 feet to be able to do it, so it's not going to happen anytime soon. So I programmed this repeater. I was assuming that it was sending tone, and when I got to the venue, or when I was, this repeater's up 1,500 feet or so, when I got to that repeater, or to within coverage of the repeater and some people talking on it, I was still 60 miles out. That's not tone. It's not tone. It's not sending tone. Requires tone, but it's not sending tone. So I'm not hearing anything, and I got to change my 45 radios. 5 mobile radios and 20 handy talkies. I'm only going to use one handy talkie, but you know, just in case, backups for the backups and even more. I got to change all those to get rid of that tone. So the handy talkie that I was planning on using, the one that is the easiest to use, is this ancient Kenwood THF6. It's always been one of my favorite handy talkies. It was the first one to come with a lithium ion battery. So a tiny battery. That would last a long, long time compared to the big clunky, heavy nickel cadmium battery packs that were on most other radios at the time. Big and clunky and were prone to memory effects and didn't last all day. And you had to carry 2 big clunky batteries and change them out at about 3 in the afternoon because the thing was going to die. So this was a great radio. 400 memories was a lot for its day. And in addition, it has a full HF receiver with a sideband detector, product detector. It'll receive sideband, upper and lower sideband, CW, RIDI, I guess, if you want to plug in a terminal unit or something. And a version of being able to do I'm losing the word here. My brain wants to say the word trunked. It's not trunked. It's memory banks, a version of memory banks. True memory banks allow you to put a limited selection of your bigger, your whole group of memories. Say you got 300 or 400 memories in a radio, and you're going to do an event like this, and you don't want to be tuning across 300 or 400 memories, figuring out what's what. You want to put in the main repeater you're going to use and the backup and maybe a simplex channel and have your radio narrowed down to that. And you don't want to bump the dial and go flying off 50 channels away to some Never Never Land. Something binged. Nope, that's not one of the guys. So a memory bank is a nice thing to have. This does not have memory banks, but it has... And plus for scanning, if you want to be able to scan a limited selection of things, scanning a memory bank is a handy way to do it. This doesn't have memory banks, but it did in this 400 memories, it gave you the option to scan in 50 memory chunks. So from 00 to 50, you could tell it scan the first 50 or the second 50 or the third 50 or the fourth or... thunder. I'm hearing thunder. If everything goes black, you know, we got hit. So this, and you could link like the first 50 with the third 50. It was fairly flexible in doing it that way for scanning. So it was a great radio back in its day. If it was still on the market, it was replaced by the D-74, the D-Star radio, and now the D-75. For all the stuff that it does, I would recommend this radio today. And it wasn't that expensive at the end anyways, selling for $300 or so. Yeah, it's not a $29.95 Bofung, but it was pretty cheap for its day. Anyway, I programmed this up using the RT system software. And I needed to take the tone out. I needed to change the memory channel for this radio that I had set up here. Let's turn on the light. There we go. That's the frequency, 147.105, a Broadway, they're called the Broadway repeater, on memory channel 355. And let's see if you can decode the... I didn't push the button. I put it in the... preview monitor and forgot to look at the program monitor. There we go. So it's 147.105. This is my shorthand for how to do alphanumerics. So it's 105. Broadway is the town that it's near. Memory channel 355. And if you can see this little thing, it says CT. Yeah, it says CT. That indicates it is subaudible tone. Encode and decode. And while I can change the tone on the fly, so it goes from no tone to encode. I can't quite see it. Okay. Yeah. No, just encode with a T and the black around it, and then CT. And then it even has a digital code. It was new enough that it had digital code in it. And then back to no tone. I can do that just while I'm looking at the memory channel. But if I switch off and switch back, it will revert back to being decode, in the decode mode. So I wanted to go through the steps of reprogramming that channel, which is simple. You push the function button and push the VFO button, and that dumps what was in the memory into VFO. And then you change the parameter that you want. So I'll get back to just tone encode only. Old radio, the buttons are getting a little flaky. No, it was latency looking at the monitor. I pushed the button too many times. Okay, so there's the function that I want, but that's in the VFO. I want to put it back into memory. So if we look at memory, memory has still got the encode, decode, VFO, just encode. And the way to store something in memory is supposed to be push the function button, have what you want in memory, in VFO, push the function button, and then push the memory button. And it should work. And let me turn the volume up so you can hear what the radio's beeping. So I push the function button, and I push the memory button, and it worked. Wait a minute. Problem with live demos. When I was out there in the field with this radio, it didn't work. And it wasn't this particular radio. This is one of my now four Kenwood THF6s. I've been acquiring them at a pretty rapid pace. It didn't work. I would push the function button and push the memory button, and it would give me a high-pitched beep, and nothing would happen. Nothing would happen. And that was what was going on with this radio as I was preparing to do the show. And I was fully expecting to push the function button and the memory button and have nothing happen. It just goes beep and did not change the memory. And that would give me the opportunity to explain to you that something went drastically wrong in the field. And I had to pull out the computer, which I had brought with me. And reprogram the radio and hope that whatever was misprogrammed in the radio would get fixed. Or at least I could set that channel the way I wanted it and reprogram the radio. And then sure enough, everything worked fine after that. So in addition, as I was trying to make things work, I'd scattershot programming, trying a bunch of different combinations of things. And one of the things I wanted to do was erase the memory. Maybe I got to erase that memory. I didn't remember having to do that, in the past, but maybe you have to do that. I couldn't remember how to delete a memory channel. Couldn't remember how. So I had to get on my phone and on the internet and say, how do you delete a memory channel in the THF6? And the procedure, which I was, just had no memory of at all, was to turn it off, hold the memory button down, and turn it back on. And you get this option to delete the memory. And you push the memory button, it will delete. Push any other button, and it will not delete. That wasn't working either. So I couldn't change the memory, and I couldn't delete the memory. And in the meantime, I had been playing with a bunch of other options, and I somehow managed to do this. I held the A and the B button, the button that changes the A side and B side, and turned it on. And now I couldn't even get to VFO. So somehow that locked. Can you hear? Wait, you can't hear that. Turn the volume up. Trying to push the VFO button and nothing. Won't change. Somehow I had done that and I had no memory of doing well. I was flying by the seat of my pants. I was doing stuff at random. And I didn't know what I had done. And eventually, I either looked it up or I played with it, and doing that function again, power on the AB button, got me back to being able to look at the VFO. Anyway, when you're doing this stuff out in the field, it's hot and you're just in your car and nothing's easy. it was a little bit frantic and a little bit frustrating. Turn off the light so it doesn't know that. Wrong buttons. I turned on the attenuator. I didn't want to do that. I do know how this stuff works. I know these radios pretty well. I've got too many radios to remember all of them. So I reprogrammed the radio from RT Systems from the computer, and then everything was fine. And why this wasn't working 15 minutes ago, 10 minutes ago, and now it is, I didn't do anything any different. I didn't even reprogram it with a computer. It just, gremlins, weird stuff. Hey, we just hit ProMore. We just hit the 30-minute mark. It's now officially a ProMore all by myself. I did a ProMore. One other thing. Do I want to save this for the main show? I was going to mention something about the Yaesu FDM300 that I put in the car. Yeah, I'll save the main comment for the show. But the sub-comment, because it goes along with this thing with this radio, is I don't remember exactly what I was doing with that radio, but wanted to tune in a different repeater on my way back. We finished up the event, and I was using the ICOM 5100 most of the time for talking on it, and the multiple other radios were listening to some other stuff, and most of the time their volumes turned down because the main repeater is all we were really using. And then suddenly the FTM300 is locked. The panel's locked. None of the buttons work. Can't tune off the repeater. Can't go anywhere. Can't do anything. The only things that worked were the volume controls. How did that happen? Had I come across instructions for how to, because I mean, all these radios have a feature where you can lock things. With this radio, if you look carefully, the upper right-hand button, the function button, it's got in blue on the, just in print above it, there's a little lock symbol. So you, and that, what that usually means, it's going to work better if I turn it on, you push and hold for those secondary functions, because there's no, this is not a function key radio. And then you got a little lock light in the upper right-hand corner, a little lock icon. And now nothing works. Nothing changes. None of the buttons work. The only thing that works is the volume control. And you push and hold it, and the radio unlocks. So the FTM300 is locked. And being a modern radio, every time you try to do anything, turn a knob or push a button, the big word locked, big tight locked, comes up on the display. It's like access denied. How did I do that? I didn't remember anything as I was going through the manual specifically. Usually I'll try every function several times to try to imprint a little bit of memory and muscle memory into those radio functions. I didn't remember having gone across a lock function for that radio at all. So I had to look it up, and I was out of cell phone range. So I had to drive someplace. This is up in the country. I had to drive someplace where I could get some coverage and pull down a manual for the FTM300 onto my phone. I could have reprogrammed it from the computer again, but I wanted to learn the function, figure what this one was. And what it is not marked on the panel. I mean, I went through the panel and everything on it 1,000 times, single press, double press, everything, and just getting that locked icon flashing at me. Wrong computer boy, radio boy. Appliance operator boy, circuit boy, you're unable to figure out your own radio, a basic simple function, and nothing on the display, nothing on the panel, nothing on the buttons icons are indicating what might lock it. So what does? Those of you with an FTM, whatever, 300, 400, probably know that it's the power button requires a press and hold to turn the radio on or off. A lot of radios do that because turning they don't want either the on or the off to be an accidental function. If you are going to turn the radio on or turn it off, they want you to do it with intention. This is what I mean to do. To turn the radio off, you push and hold for about a second, and it goes off. Turn it on, you got to push and hold for about a second, and it comes on. And by the way, not with a 15-second boot up time like Anytone. Attention, Anytone, another modern radio. It's booting up in about 3 seconds. So the function for locking the display, for locking everything, is the power button. A quick press of the power button locks the radio, and a quick press unlocks the radio. So clearly, in thinking I was going to turn it on or off or absentmindedly not doing anything or pushing the wrong button, I managed to press that button, and we were locked, and I didn't know that that's what I did, and I didn't know that's what would undo it until I looked it up, and I was like, of course. Well, not even of course. It wasn't me being stupid. It wasn't intuitive. Nothing intuitive about it. Which leads me to my rant. Well, not really a rant, just my short essay on figuring out how to program radios. If you're the designer, you've got a handful of buttons to deal with, a couple of knobs, and a couple more buttons on the front panel. And you don't, an HF radio, some HF radios came with 100 buttons on the front panel so that they could have each of those buttons do one function or maybe two. But on a mobile radio, you don't have that option. You've got 5-6 buttons, maybe your volume control and your tuning knobs can be buttons as well. You know, you tune them to do something, but you press them to do something else. But you've really only got maybe 10 or 15 discrete functions that you can do and assign them to the to the buttons on the panel without having to do anything else, without having to go any deeper into the radio. A limited number of functions. But you've designed 200 functions into the radio, 200 different things it can do. But the operator has to manipulate their way through them. Not all of them are going to be done every day. Some may be set once and never done again. They can be buried pretty deep. So you end up with menus and submenus and a menu where you do something to get to a menu and you push another button and it opens up a menu below that and maybe a menu below that. I've seen 3-4 deep. And as you're getting started, you can do it. A few options are intuitive and logical, or maybe they're only intuitive and logical if you're basing the logic of what you're doing on predecessor radios or brother and sister radios in the same of the same brand that operate similarly, and say, well, all these radios, pushing this button changes the power. So on my radio, pushing this button is going to change the power. Low, medium, high. Something that an operator may want to do at will, frequently. And so things like that, things you're going to do frequently, get assigned to single button pushes, or maybe either push and hold or function push, depending on which way you go with the radio. Some radios have a function button and then a push. Some it's push and hold. Some are function, push and hold. Starts to get a little bit crazy. And then you go for your secondary options, your secondary functions. That is the first screen of menus. And then the less and less used are, go down from there. You can be intuitive about the first handful of things to do. And then it's just a scramble. I got a function. you know, it's the function where we're going to change the tone. Where do I put that? Because you don't do that very often. You know, you set that and it's done forever. Where do I put that? I'll put it under this submenu over here. No logic to it at all. Just that's where it's going to go. And because now you're scrambling, the boss is breathing down your neck. They want to get this radio finished. They want to get it tested. They want to get it on the market. Christmas is coming. And would you hurry up and get that programming done? Okay, just I'm going to throw this here, throw this there, throw this here. And that's the way it looks as you're now the radio operator trying to figure out where's that function? How do I go change the tone? How do I lock the radio? Oh, we'll put the lock on the power button. Should we put a note on here? Well, there's not really any room around it to put a little lock icon on it. And it's already got the power icon on it. We'll put it in the manual and people will figure it out. That's what happened to me. That's my rant. Is that, do I have a, no, I'm at clickbait. I'm not at rant. I'm at clickbait. It's worth changing. I'm in the pro more. It's worth changing. Just takes a second. Takes 10 seconds. There we go. Rant. Instant editorial rant. Now, should I change it back to clickbait? No. We use the instant editorial rant more often than we use clickbait. They're interestingly positioned on the screen. I can see it on my promo. You can't see it here. Why are they like that? Well, they're designed to sit on top of this. Really should put them somewhere else. Put it all somewhere else. I think I'm done. I haven't woken up anybody else from the California side of the crew yet. So this show is the promo is officially done. I guess I could go look and see if anybody.
This episode.
Quiet. I haven't. Haven't looked to see if anybody's talking to me yet. I'm looking over here at. No, none of the guys. Nobody's chatting. Nobody's seeing anything. Is there anybody even still streaming? Well, there's me. No, there's three people looking. And they're not chatting. How about Facebook? Anybody say anything over there? What is this? What do the kids on Facebook want me to do? Add a chat. Making plans, add a chat to start coordinating. What the heck? What are we talking about? And I have a comment. Ah, my friend Charles, I'm surprised I still am here. I don't talk to Charles. Charles is W4CL, Charles Leno, the broadcast engineer up in the Greensboro area. I don't talk to him on ham radio anymore. Whenever I drive through the territory, he's on GMRS. I talked to him on GMRS. I don't remember his call sign on GMRS anymore. I've never remembered it. It was WRTX. I can't remember. I can't remember anybody's GMRS call sign except barely my own. WRPG652, rocket propelled grenade. Anyway, he was watching, I guess. Does this tell me anybody else is watching? What does it tell me? Doesn't tell me much. I thought it would tell me how many are watching. But, oh, yeah. Okay, yeah, up here. It's hiding behind that. There's a little I and a 1. And I think that's me. So there must be something going on. That picture is also terrible. What's the story with that picture? What am I looking at? Oh, it's we're going into the endless loop version. What's the story on that? How bad that picture is? How bad are we on? How bad are we on YouTube? YouTube's bad too. I may have something to fix here. I may have something I need to fix. Let me check the settings. Oh, it says it's at 720. And yet it's horrible. Great. I've got something else to fix. All right. Let me get out of here and go find out why the picture is bad. Go into YouTube. I'll be doing that testing as a private channel. You won't be able to see it. Sorry. But if it's a problem on YouTube and a problem on Facebook, both, it's going to be something common to Wirecast. Okay. Let's see. Okay. Let's see. Okay. I'm trying to turn.
Okay.
I'm trying to turn.
Okay.
There we go. Get everything turned off because I need this channel for playing the music. No, I didn't. I need the channel for playing the sound effects. So the show is... my genius plan for 60 meters. Apparently you can barely read this because the picture is so fuzzy. And the crew should be here. I've invited somebody else. I don't know if they're going to get them here. Oh, Charles is WRQW960. Yeah. And he says the picture's bad. He should know. This is where you need a good signal report. No, a bad signal report. That's a good signal report. So you know what's going on. Anyway, I'll go try to fix that, find out whatever's going on. I'm glad I caught that. And in the meantime, we'll see you tonight with the rest of the crew. Again, a guest I've invited, but I don't know if they're gonna come or not. And this is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. Over and out.